Hey, everybody, it's Mark Pattison, former NFL player, now climbing the seven summits, and welcome to another fantastic episode of Finding Your Summit, all about people overcoming adversity and finding their way. Okay, look, 7, 8 years ago, I had to step into the fear and put a big-ass goal out there, and so I decided to start climbing all these crazy mountains around the world. It's been an absolute amazing journey. And, you know, I can't believe I'm saying this, but I've actually done 6 of the 7. I've actually been on Denali twice. I've been on climb successfully, Kilimanjaro twice. But now it's Mount Everest, the biggest boy on the block, 29,000 plus. And I'm headed over there April 2020. And I'm totally keyed up. And I'm keyed up because I've been doing all this preparation. I train like an absolute bear. And, really putting myself in a position of success. I'm going to be climbing with one of the top climbing outfitters in the world. Excited about that. And just the mountain has fascinated me for years, I'm sure like others, but really excited to do so. And so if I can actually pull this thing off, I'd be the first NFL player to do so. And so as we speak today, there's not that many first in the world. So I look forward to tackling that. Okay, so that's one. Two is I totally appreciate the listen on these different podcasts. I really do. And it's been an amazing journey, as I said, from not just interviewing these people, but being on the other side of the mic and really taking in their incredible stories of doing amazing things. And look, we all need to be inspired. And so if I can help provide and find more people that meet that criteria, all the better. And it just, we all need that motivation, and we all need that those words of encouragement that you can make it back relevant to your own situation and then plow forward in whatever endeavor you are trying to do. Okay, so I appreciate that. And if you want to find out anything that I have going on, you can do so at markpattisonnfl.com. I've got a book out now called Finding Your Summit, go figure. And it is essentially the playbook to what I had learned from my Hall of Fame coaches on how to emerge and do some great things in your life. It doesn't have to be mountain climbing, of course. It can be anything, but it's a plug-in that you take on these different things, these different goals, that these different strategies that I've set forth, that they set forth for me. And good things can come from that. Okay. Also on the website, you can find out more about my expedition. Obviously, I'll be going to Mount Everest, and we'll have more information about that coming up. There's an e-learning course and, of course, the podcast. And when you go to the podcast, you will find an iTunes tab. And I would be so grateful if you go in and you'd rate and review. Now, it all has to do with visibility, popularity of podcasts, because there's so many podcasts out there today that it's so easy to get lost and like, wait, where's Finding Your Summit? And I really do believe these stories are really amazing and incredible and can really give a lift to those people who really need it. And even if you don't, we all need to be motivated and inspired by other people to keep going. So if you'd go in and do that, I would be really, really appreciative. Okay, so let's go listen to the pod. It's going to be awesome. Here we go. Hey, everybody, it's Mark Pattison. I'm back again with another great episode of Finding Your Summit, all about people overcoming adversity and finding their way. And I was in Seattle not too long ago. I'm broadcasting from Sun Valley, my home studio. And I was there to visit my mother. My mother said, Mark, you got to come to church, and you're going to come to this place that I've been very inspired by. And so, of course, I said, no problem. Where am I going to meet you? And that led me to Bethany Church, just again, outside of Seattle, right across the street, more or less from Green Lake. And who I went and saw and heard was Pastor Richard Dahlstrom. So today I've got Pastor Richard on the pod. I'm excited about it to see where this conversation is going to go. So the first thing I want to do is welcome Pastor Richard. How are you doing?
I'm doing really well, Mark. Thanks for the invitation. It's good to be here with you. I'm calling in actually today from the East Coast. I'm speaking at a conference out here in Maryland. So looking forward to getting back to the West, where it's a little bit drier. The air is a little bit less humid, but I'm out here East today. So it's good.
Yeah. So, you know, my mom, you know, when she's, so if I were to rank people in order, it'd be the God, then, or God, then, the Pope,
Mother Teresa, and then my mother would be somewhere, you know, under there. So just,
that's awesome.
Yeah. So you just understand the pecking order, the way these things work. And so she invites me out and she goes, this is the reason why you're going to be inspired, because there were so many stories, metaphors about the mountains, and Pastor Richard loves to hike and climb. He might even have a place around Snoqualmie Summit, and he's been all over the world. And there's this draw for him. So let me just start. And then what I want to do is I want to understand the connection between how you got to be in the ministry, how you got to be a pastor, and what that connection for you is with the mountains and being in the outdoors.
Very cool, man. Yeah. So where do you want to start?
Well, I want to start with, you know, how did you develop a love for the mountains?
Oh, cool. Well, so I grew up in Fresno, California, which is right outside of Yosemite. And I thought that that would kind of seal my fate as a mountain lover. But my dad, when I was very young, my dad developed severe pneumonia followed by bronchitis, which ultimately took his life when he was only 53 years old. Super unfortunate. Never smoked a cigarette in his life, but he died young, and he could never really go above about 3,000 feet elevation without without really huffing and puffing. Yeah. So we ended up, even though I was in Fresno and had been to Yosemite maybe once as a kid, we ended up really never spending time in the mountains. But then when my dad died, I decided I was going to take a break from God. I was pretty mad at suffering in the world and how life seemed so random and capricious and that kind of thing. So I headed off to the coast of California, to Cal Poly in San Luis Obispo, yep, to study architecture. And then when I was there studying architecture, I had a longer story maybe than today. I write about it in a book called The Map Is Not the Journey, where my wife and I hiked through the Alps for 40 days. Yeah. But I was studying architecture. I had this God encounter. I ended up changing majors and moving to Seattle to study music, right? And so when I was studying music, here I am, a music major, and I meet this girl who eventually becomes my fiance and my wife of now 40 years. And she's an outdoor recreation major. And we meet in a speech class. So I'm the music major, she's outdoor rec. And so she starts inviting me on these outings that her class is doing. So on the weekends now, like I'm in a practice room banging on the piano all week long. And then on the weekends, I'm out running 10Ks, or I'm climbing or rock climbing or sailing or kayaking or canoeing. Because get this, those were her classes. What's not to love about being an outdoor rec major, right?
My God.
I got into it completely. And that was kind of the beginning of my love affair with mountains. I married that woman. And ever since then, I have found that hiking, rock climbing, and mountaineering are the best teachers of what it means to live a whole life. I really feel like when I'm out there, I'm learning lessons that could not be learned anywhere else. So I started doing some rock climbing and some mountaineering, mostly in the Cascades, done a little bit of rock climbing in the Alps. But my wife and I then, we started a program, and the best way to describe it would be a blend of Bible school and Outward Bound, where we were integrating Bible teaching with rock climbing, rappelling, mountaineering, and backpacking. And we did that for 6 years, and it just sealed in my soul the importance of everybody getting out and encountering what God has to say to us directly through creation, not just living inside of our heads by studying a text. So there's been no turning back since then, honestly.
Yeah, no, there's a lot to unpack there, so I want to do so. So the first thing is, I want to go back to your dad passing away at 53, right? And I'm 57.
Yeah.
You might be older or younger than me, but I have two girls, and you know, it becomes very important, obviously, to me to lead a healthy life, a life of self-care and being in the mountains and providing for them in the right way. What did that do to you in terms of, I mean, you know, my dad has passed away as well. And so these things are never easy, but at least he was 80, 82 years old. And so, you know, 53 is pretty doggone young.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it was hard. I was 17 and I came home from a high school football game, and my mom's, like, I was playing in the marching band. My mom goes, hey, your dad's in a coma in the hospital.
Yeah.
And the doctors don't think he's going to live through the night. So I went to the hospital and had those last moments with dad. It was weird because he was super athletic as a young man, a young adult. When he was in college, he worked in the oil fields in Central California to put himself through college, and he played on a couple of baseball teams at night in the summer and basketball in the winter. But when he was a young kid, like 6-7 years old, he contracted pneumonia every winter, and it just thrashed his lungs. Mm. So that by the time he turned 40, his lungs were really, really weak. And I got to tell you, Mark, it was so painful because this guy who never smoked and really wanted to take care of himself, but those early bouts with pneumonia, they just thrashed him. So he'd come home. He was a high school principal, and he'd come home from work, and he would basically, like, he'd play horse with me, try to play basketball with me, and I'd watch him huffing and puffing, and he'd have to go inside after about 5 minutes. And it was just really, really hard to see that. That started when he was about 40 years old, and then ultimately he died when he was 53. But I tell you, as a result of that, on the physical side, it really convinced me that I need to really steward the body that God has given me and the days that God has given me. Mm. And so as a result of that, I've developed this theology that I don't hear often enough in faith communities that declares, hey, when God made us, he made us his whole people. We're not just brains. We're not just spirits. We're spirits, and we have soul, like a mind and an emotional being, and we have a body. And those things all work together as an ecosystem, so that if I'm not caring for my body, then I'm going to pay the price in my spirit and my soul. If I'm not caring for my spirit, I'll pay for the price in my body. I mean, we all know people whose spiritual and emotional lives are a wreck, and as a result, they're either stuck into some addictive behavior, or they're not sleeping well, or they don't have a good relationship with food, or they hate their body. So when my dad died, I was like this: I really want to steward the whole thing, including my body, because I can't be of any good to anybody unless my body is operating at its maximum efficiency, you know? So I try and get out and we live right near the Pacific Crest Trail. So about 3 days a week, when I'm up there, I'm out running on the PCT just near our house, or doing a little rock climbing, a little scrambling and that kind of thing. And it's good for the spirit, but it's also good for the body and the soul. So that I think my dad's death really affected me that way, at the very least, right? I decided I really want to take care of my body. And honestly, I'm not kidding. Every time I'm out running, or I'm like, I've got an ice axe in my hand, and I know this feeling, Mark, mm-hmm. when you're chugging up an ice field, I am so grateful for every single breath, because every breath is a gift, isn't it?
No, it of course is a gift. And I think one thing you said in there, which was really telling, is I think, first of all, when your dad passed away, you're 17 years old, you know, it really made you think and pause and be determined about the kind of life that you want to live, and understand that life is fragile. The second part of that was, and you said it a little bit differently, but these are my words, but having that body, that mind, that spirit, that soul all work in unison, you know, really needs to come together. And I think a lot of times those things are easy to say, and you can go to the gym, but you don't have the other parts, your spirit, your kindred spirit, your attitude of gratitude, your lens that you look through when you view other people, the world, perspective on what you have versus what others may not. And ultimately that resulting in a positive lifestyle about affecting others in a really amazing way. I think for me, and I think this is everything that you're talking about, is that when you get in nature and you get your phone unplugged and it's not ringing, your computer and you're tethered to your computer, it's really, you get in this state of being really connected with earth. And at the end of the day, you know, God is what created this earth. And so I can't think of a better place. For me, 7-8 years ago, I was going through a rough period of time. I'm ashamed to say that my marriage did not work out. But you know, at the end of the day, you do have to move on. You do have to go forward. And during that journey, that led me into the mountains on this quest to climb these crazy mountains all over the world. But it's just not about that touching and high-fiving at the top of the mountain, but it's the people that you interact with. It's about the new landscapes, you know, whether it's on Denali or down in Argentina in Aconcagua or in Antarctica where I was in this last January. You know, these things all, like, you're out there just going, this is the most amazing place I've ever been. And you really get to take it in and breathe it out and just soak in the culture that exists in these different parts of the world.
Totally. And it's what that sounds like as I listen to you is that you have that kind of same perspective of gratitude for the kind of the privilege of receiving everything that, and you can call it creation or nature or the great spirit or God, but everything that God wants to give you through creation. And as a pastor, I go, man, both the Jewish tradition and the Christian tradition are filled with passages in the Bible that say we're learning about the goodness of God and the glory of God through creation, so that every time I'm taking a breath, it's gratitude. And it just, I got to say, it just pains me then to see people, like we live right at Snoqualmie Pass, right? So we're up there, we ski quite a bit in the wintertime. And it just pains me to see people, you're out there and good Lord, we're skiing, which means A, we're healthy. B, we got the resources to do it. C, the air is clean. And I hear people, you know, fighting on the lift and swearing that, you know, it's a bad day and they're unhappy. And I go, wow, like, how is it that we can be in this incredible environment and yet somehow it's disconnected from our spirit? And if it's disconnected from our spirit, we don't enjoy it as much anyway. And then that turns around and bites us in the body, right? Because now we're living on cortisol and adrenaline rather than enjoying peace. So I do think seeing it as an ecosystem and then viewing every day as a gift is really a way forward to become the people who live up to the potential that we have within us, you know?
Hey, this pod is sponsored by Laird Superfoods. So many products to choose from your InstaFuel, your coffee, your tea, your smoothies. And I love the superfood creamer and use the hydration powders like the beets, the coconut, the matcha, the turmeric to mix all into my 7 Summit smoothie. And it's so good. Log on to LairdSuperfood.com and get your 20% off when you use the code MarkP20. Okay? So get your Laird Superfood, and I guarantee it will help fuel your journey.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense to me. And I think a fault that I had for many years, and I popped out of it when I was around 50. So it took me 50 years to, like, you know, really understand and get this. But I operated a lot as sort of a tornado, right? And when you don't take that time out to really pause and think, and people can talk about yoga or meditation or quiet time or reading the Bible. I mean, you can put any word you want to put in there, the filler. I've got my own little routines now, but you know, I literally picked up my life and I said, I'm like reinventing myself in a different way. I don't think I was as conscious about it as the way it's played out, but literally moved from Hermosa Beach, California, Southern California, where I'm sure you've been to this small, teeny tiny town called Sun Valley, which has got about 4,000 people. And life, it just goes at a different pace. But for me, window, and I'm staring at the mountain, and I've got birds chirping and a moose doing whatever they do, elk and all this kind of stuff. Yep. It's just the beauty of nature. And it's just a whole lot different thing than just racing down I-5 a million miles per hour and just going, because, you know, again, we go back to what you just said. It's all connected. It's all connected about the way you think about life and the way you treat people. One thing that's in here that I really love, it's a saying or something. It's called the disciplines of self-care. And I want you to talk about this really quickly, because essentially, I mean, you're being very metaphorical about this, but you're saying, you know, essentially why your oxygen mask goes on first. And I know you're talking about, you know, connecting the dots with where I'll be next year on Mount Everest. of why you need to have an oxygen mask on. But really, there's a bigger picture, and I want you to get into that about what that means.
Yeah, you know, a metaphor that I use in my teaching is I believe that we're designed to live our life out from a full cup. So if I have a full cup and I see you on the side of the road and you're thirsty, then I have the resources to say, hey, Mark, come on over here, man. There's plenty in my cup. Come, let me share with you. And that whole mindset is it creates a mentality of abundance where I go, there's not just enough, there's more than enough, right? And for that mentality to prevail in my day-to-day living, I actually have to have a full cup. And by full cup, I mean kind of full emotionally, like I'm not living in shame and guilt and self-condemnation, and bodily, I'm not living in, you know, tension and sleeplessness and self-medicating with Ben and Jerry's and booze or something like that. Like I'm my cup is full through self-care and this posture receiving, but it's the goal of the receiving isn't so that I can have a full cup. The goal of having a full cup is so that I can turn around and share with you, right? And so the best, kind of best, fullest lives that I see are not lives that are obsessed with self-care, but they're lives that are seeking to have their own cup full so that they can serve other people. And so when you see people then who are involved in search and rescue, who are involved in ski patrol, who are involved in feeding the homeless, who are involved in community meals or community development work, who are involved in crossing social divides and that kind of thing, everyone who's out doing that stuff, their cup is full. You know what I mean? Like they're not so obsessed with gazing at their own navel that they're just living for themselves and their own accomplishments, but they're able to kind of serve others. And I think that that's a really good goal. But if that's the goal, then I'm not going to live the life of a martyr, you know, just continually burning out as I try and meet every need that I see everywhere. I have to have my own cup filled as well. So that's where I need these habits of self-care to make this work.
Well, I think you're spot on. And you see this literally in so many different examples of self-care. And I was talking about this with somebody the other day. I'm doing Mount Rainier this next weekend. You know, the whole key as I co-guide this thing up with some other Navy SEALs is to make sure that you really understand what self-care means. And that's taking care of yourself,
you bet,
sitting down and putting a heavy jacket on and having the right nutrition. And we're talking about, metaphorically speaking right now, we're talking about the crossover between mountain climbing, but just in daily life, like you're talking about getting a massage or going to work out or going for a jog, or as you were talking about living in a place up on top of a ski pass in the Snoqualmie Summit, you can access the mountains really quickly and then also run, you know, on the Pacific Crest Trail that probably feeds your soul in a way that you can turn around and really help others in a really positive
way.
Right? I mean, it's just that energy. Yep. And that's the other part about this too, is that the once you do that, your spirit about, you know, somebody that comes up and just their energy is just, it's just like, wow, I want to get some of that. How do I do that?
Totally. Hey, I'll tell you a story that kind of fits along these lines.
Yeah.
The very first time I climbed, I was climbing Mount Baker and it was a guided thing. And I was in my early 20s, just, you know, having gotten into it a little bit there. And so I'm with this group and we're up on the Easton Glacier, if you know it. And we're getting up near the summit. And we sit for a break and a guy allows his ice axe, like he takes his ice axe off of his wrist and then he inadvertently kicks it. And we watch it just kind of slide down the glacier into a crevasse. Right.
Oh.
And so then the guide is like this, he goes, look, I'm going to go get that because we can't summit without it. Because if you know Baker, there's a big bergschrund just at the top that you got to cross over and you really got to have your ice axe. So, we're all sitting there and I watch this guy. Now, mind you, this is like probably about 9,500 feet or whatever. It's really near the top, but all of us are sea level people. And like our hearts are really, you know, beating, we got headaches and all that stuff. This guy goes down, he plants an anchor, and then he rappels down into the crevasse, gets the ice axe, uses the senders on the rope, goes back up, hikes back up to us, hands the guy the ice axe, then leads us to the top. And I was like this, that was so impressive, because I realized his cup was full, right? Like, yeah. He didn't just have enough to get his own butt to the top of the mountain. He had enough in his tank that when this little mini crisis occurred, he had the energy to go down, get the ice axe, come back up, and still is at the top. And I go, man, I want to live my life that way, right? Yeah. So that I have enough that when somebody needs me emotionally, physically, if somebody needs help financially, I would be able to give out of what the full cup that I have, rather than living with a scarcity mentality. And I honestly think we live in a culture right now where fear seems to be prevailing and the scarcity mentality seems to be prevailing. My hope is that more and more of us can say, no, there's plenty for everybody, you know, and we can begin to live with that generosity of spirit and body.
Yeah. You know, one of the things I love about that, kind of towards the end, you were talking about, you know, the fear, and what I've continued to say, because I had to do it, frankly, which is step into the fear and take chances in a way, calculated risk, of course, but that's where your true greatness comes, because so many people play defense. Part of that too is just really understanding that to do that, you have to take all to take all the necessary steps to put you in the best position of success to ultimately attain.
You bet.
Right? I mean, there's a whole peeling back the onion and layers of what that really means, but it really does. And if you do that, I think there are so many of life's amazing surprises. And I hear all the time about people, they're so fearful of me going up on Everest and these other mountains I've climbed. And it's just like, you don't understand. There's nobody that trains harder than what I do than me. Now, I'm not saying there's other people like you and others, I guess, that probably are at the same level, but there's nobody more. And I do that because, again, it feeds my soul. So that feeds that checks
totally
the box of self-care, but it also puts me in preparation and doing these things. You know, I wouldn't do something foolish like run across I-5 on, you know, rush hour.
Right.
Because that's stupid. Right. Right? But again, calculated risk, going in the right way. The other side of that whole thing too, just on the flip side of when you don't take care of yourself so that you can help others and really get into a mode of contribution, which is, I think, that the ultimate in happiness and fulfillment as a person, that you can really help somebody else. But again, making sure your bucket's full first, is a guy that I tent mated with down in Antarctica, and, you know, wonderful guy, wonderful family man, a bunch of kids, wife, the whole thing. And he was just depressed, and he just never took care of himself in the right way. He didn't have the self-care. And you could see this coming. And 6 months earlier last year, he had lost a bunch of fingers and toes up on Denali. And then now I find him down as my tent mate. And he was one of the first Americans that passed away and died on top of Mount Everest this last year, mainly because there wasn't self-care. He hadn't done the work. And it was just something that was very predictable. And, you know, I feel awful for obviously him. He's sitting up on top of Mount Everest at 29,000 feet. But again, I'm making a bad example of when you don't have self-care, when you haven't had the preparation that creates the opportunity that bad things can happen, and you can literally fall down a hole into that crevasse you were just talking about. And where your story was all about the guy pulling himself back out of it and coming back up and leading to the top. Others that haven't had that preparation sink to the bottom and they never come out.
Well, and the other nuance to what we're talking about is there's a time and a place to turn around, you know, and we've all kind of followed the Everest tragedies last month or so. I guess it was the end of May or so when there was that big traffic jam on the ridge, you know. Yeah, yeah. But it reminded me of when we ran our wilderness ministry. There was a guy who had come over from Europe, and he was trained to be a mountain guide. So he knew his stuff. and was considerably more hardcore than the rest of our group. And so we were going to do a summit of Baker, and we did our, you know, we did our crevasse rescue training, and we camped on the glacier. And then on summit day, a couple of people, they just, honestly, they weren't ready. And so they kind of self-selected out, and our guide made the decision that we were all going to turn around rather than risk leaving these people alone on the mountain. We were all going to turn around. And that meant this mountain guide who had really, he shared later that night. He goes, one of the reasons I came to this program is it's on my bucket list to climb a volcano. Like, I've climbed in the Alps, but I wanted to climb one of the volcanoes. And he said, and yet, he said, for me, the best growth that has happened in the 6 weeks I've been here has been when the guide said, we're going to turn around. I knew I could go up on my own and blow everybody off. Mm. But the best thing that I learned was to say no to my ego and turn around, which I was like, that's pretty amazing, right? Like, we're so ego-driven and so goal-driven in our lives that sometimes we overestimate our own capacity. And sometimes even when we have capacity, our pushing ahead can be damaging to other people. So I was so impressed that this guy said the biggest learning moment of the 6 weeks for him, it was better than had he gone to the summit. He said, turning around 300 feet from the top was so, it was the hardest thing I've ever done. And it caused me more growth. Isn't that amazing?
No, it is. Well, I've had to do it. And the way I'm wired, it's really hard for me to do that. But I totally understand everything you're saying, because it hits home. And sometimes you have to call it, you know, you really have to understand what's in the best interest of the group, not yourself. And that's everything you're
exactly.
So let me ask you this. So my mother was just here visiting in Sun Valley. And I said, hey, Mom, great news. Remember the guy that you took me to go see speak in Seattle, Pastor Richard? She goes, yep. And I go, well, listen, I've got him on the podcast. I go, you know, I've not done any kind of research on this guy. I don't know what I'm going to talk to him about. So what would you ask? So I asked this to my mother, AKA Mary, and she says, yeah. Why did he get into preaching? So that I'm posing that question via, you know, I'm channeling through my mother, you know, how did you get into, so, cause you started with architecture and then you got into music, and somehow your wife of now 40 years has kind of easily dragged you into the mountains, and now you've had this love. And I haven't heard how this connection between, you know, the outdoors and how you became a pastor. And I mean, you've got a really great thing going at Bethany, and it was really fun to be a part of that. You've got a fantastic music scene there, and the way you speak to the crowd, the audience, you know, yeah. Really receptive and really cool. So I just want to connect these dots. Like, how did you get into the ministry?
Hey, thanks for asking. That's a super interesting question. And like my short answer that is kind of hard for me to understand is I say, God tricked me and I became a pastor. But the kind of longer answer is, you know, I went away. I was going to become an architect. I was kind of taking a vacation from God. And then I went off when I was studying at Cal Poly University in California. I went off to a ski retreat. This cute girl had invited me to go on a ski retreat, and I decided to go, and it was at a camp, and the guy speaking, he's just like you, he's a motivational speaker basically, but he was speaking, and his theme for the weekend was knowing God. Mm. And so he gets up to talk and he said, I'm just here to tell you guys that none of you are ever going to end up living the life for which you're created unless you make knowing God a central goal. And like at that point in my life, I had kind of taken a vacation from God basically and was angry at God. But when that guy spoke, something about what he said totally resonated with me. And I was like this, you know what? I'll say it this way. I said, I'm going to give God a second chance. And I went out and I prayed in the snow and I said, God, I don't know what this means for me, you know, vocationally or professionally or in any way, but I really want to make an effort to know you. I want to be able to say at the end of my life, I know God, right? So I prayed that prayer, and then, you know, I was involved in the dorm in an evening kind of Bible study thing, and I was just playing piano at this thing, and it just took off. It grew like crazy from, you know, 20 students to 50 to 80, and it was so exciting to me that suddenly the notion of designing buildings just didn't seem like what I was cut out to do. Oh. And I thought, oh, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to help people get to know God in some way. And I thought it was going to be through music. So I changed majors and moved to Seattle and studied music, met my wife there. And then I worked in the music kind of industry for a couple of years, but found that I was still just, I got really hungry to understand the Bible. I don't know if you read the Bible or not, but it can be a stinking hard book to understand. I mean, I talked to a lot of people who are like, yeah, I started in Genesis, man, but when God started killing people in the book of Joshua, I just shut that thing down and walked away. And so I was like this, I want to understand this stuff. Like, does God really do that? Does God still do that? Like, what's going on? And so I headed off to seminary to study the Bible. And then I thought, you know what, I'm going to be a Bible professor. And because of my love of the outdoors, I sought out a place called Alaska Bible College. It's in the, like, it's in the interior between Anchorage and Fairbanks on the Copper River. And I'd gone up there, I'd flown up there, I'd interviewed, and I was going to be a Bible teacher there and teach a couple of music composition and stuff like that. And then I was going to fly up on the North Slope and do stuff with Inuits. And I was super excited about it. But to make a long story short, the kind of job fell through, and I'd taken a job, like a temporary job as a pastor in the San Juan Islands, Washington State, in a place called Friday Harbor. I don't know if you know it or not.
Oh yeah. Great spot.
That is a great spot. So I was a pastor there, and I moved up there in 1984. I was going to be there 6 months. And then I ended up staying actually 6 years, because when this position fell through in Alaska, due to some finances and stuff up at the Bible school, then the church leaders said, hey, we'd like to stay and be our pastor. And I didn't have anything else going. I had just given birth to my wife giving birth to our first child. So I was like this, yeah, well, I think this is where we're meant to be. So we stayed there till 1990. And then in 1990, we moved to Marble Mount, which is like right outside of North Cascades National Park. And we did our wilderness thing for 6 years. And then in 1990, December 95, I think it was, I started leading Bethany Community Church. And the way that I ended up there was just insane. I was in India, Mark, teaching, and up in the Himalayas in this tiny little community doing some teaching. And a guy there says to me, in 1993, a guy goes, hey, I used to be a missionary supported by Bethany Community Church in Seattle. And then he says to me, God wants you to be the pastor. Like it was like a prophecy or something. And I said, oh, whatever. I don't want to be. Like, I'm living in the North Cascades, man. I'm as happy as I could ever be. And then the church in Seattle invited me to come speak for a week, which is kind of what I do. It's what you do. You know, somebody invites you, you go, right?
Yeah.
So I went and I spoke. And that was 2 years later in April of 95. And then they said, they called me back right after I spoke. And they said, we think that you're meant to be our next senior pastor. We want you to consider filling out an application. And because of what that guy said in India, I thought, man, if this is my destiny, then it'll happen. So I filled out the app, and it was kind of funny because I wasn't sure I really wanted the job, And when you don't think you want the job, you're able to be super honest in the interview process, you know? So I went in and I basically tried to talk him out of it. You know, I said, look, I'm not your guy. You know, I love living in the mountains and I don't have the management experience. And the church I lead in the mountains is about 20 people. And you say you want somebody who's led a church of 500 people. And I gave him all the reasons why I was the wrong guy. And this is how they responded. They said, you're the first honest candidate we met. We love that. And so we actually want you all the more. So no matter what I said, it's like they just kept saying, yeah, you're the guy. And then they voted, the whole congregation voted, and it was unanimous. Like it was 125 to nothing or whatever it was. And as soon as that happened, my wife leaned over. She said, God just spoke. Do you know what he said? And I said, no, what did he say? She says, well, God just spoke. He said, checkmate. Like we knew, like we just knew we had to move to Seattle. We knew it was like our destiny, basically. And you know what? It was really, my takeaway from that whole experience is on the front end, I didn't want to go. I didn't want to leave the mountains. I didn't want to live in the city. I want to pastor a big church. But you know what? Looking back now, 25 years later, that was the best decision we ever made. So it's kind of cool to, and you know this, I know you do from reading your stuff. It's cool to have goals, but to hold them with an open hand. Yeah. So that like your life can be shaped by whether you call it God or destiny or whatever. If you live your life with an open hand, rather than clinging to your goals or being too attached to your goals, it's going to be a much greater adventure. Absolutely. Much greater adventure. Like the life that I've lived, I could never plan it. Like I've been able to speak on every continent except Antarctica, basically, you know, and enjoy the mountains all around the world, a little bit like you, not to the heights of you, but I am so grateful. And yet I feel like if I'd have said when I was 10, that's what I'm going to do, it wouldn't have happened. Isn't that wild? Like, I feel like the wind has blown me along.
Yeah, well, it's blown you along, but it's also given this little word called purpose, and behind a purpose is a strong why.
That's right.
Right. And so yeah. I think that's something that you found when you found yourself, I'm making this up, but on your knees and you're asking God, what's my purpose? And the question that you're asking to yourself out loud, to the birds, anybody that would listen, was really understanding and knowing God. I think there's different levels of that, right? So you went and you kind of went to a whole different level where you're going to commit your whole life towards really studying, becoming a professor, your words, and understanding, so you could reinterpret and talk to others about what that meant to you. So for the average layman like myself, and when you're talking about knowing God, what are like the three or four bullet points of like, hey, if you really want to know God, this is what you need to do. Check, check, check. And you will be well on your way.
Well, that's a great question. It's a great question. Well, I think the shortest answer I give would be this. The best expression of God, the clearest expression of God is Jesus. So don't confuse Jesus with institutional Christianity or the church, because none of us who run the institution get it right perfectly. But when you look at Jesus in the Bible, Jesus is the one who is advocating for people who are caught in trouble. Jesus is the one crossing social divides. Jesus is the one laying down his weapons. Jesus is the one going the second mile. Jesus is the one loving his enemies. And so if I really want to see the character of God, then I have to look at Jesus, because Jesus is generous and joyful and honest and celebratory and healing and forgiving. And so that's like, Jesus is the best way, in a sense, to know God. But there's other ways. Also, even in the Bible, we read this, we get to know something about God's character through creation, right? So I love, when I'm out hiking, to think about how these streams are providing water for fish, for trees, for all the food that I'm going to eat later that evening. Mm-hmm. And that water in that stream came from snow, but that snow came because clouds came in from the Pacific, and those clouds come in from the Pacific and they fall in snow, and then the snow melts and it becomes the stream, and then the stream flows all the way back to the Pacific Ocean, and then the water evaporates again And this has been going on for millions of years, so that like every breath we take, every bite of food we eat is a testimony to God's generous provision. Mm-hmm. You know, isn't that amazing? Like, so by thinking about creation and pondering the beauty of creation and the ecosystem of creation and the fact that the trees are exhaling oxygen and inhaling carbon dioxide, and we're exhaling carbon dioxide and inhaling oxygen, so us and the trees have a thing going together. All of that is like, it's all a revelation of God's goodness and God's character. So I get to know God through Jesus. I get to know God through creation, and I get to know God through other people. When I talk to you, when I listen to your podcast and see how people have overcome tremendous obstacles in their lives, mm-hmm. to live a full life, that's inspiring. And the word inspire literally means to breathe in, right? And in the Bible, spirit and breath are the same word. So like when I'm inspired by someone, I'm receiving like a spiritual feeding from that person, because when someone overcomes a difficulty or challenge or handicap, that overcoming is spiritually meaningful to me and inspiring. And it's part of God's character, right? So I try to summarize then, I try and learn about God through Jesus. And that comes from, you know, basically reading particularly the Gospels of the Bible, but then also through creation and also through other people, because once we hear somebody's story, 9 times out of 10, it's inspiring.
Hey, I'm excited to introduce our new partner of the pod, Cascade Mountain Tech, an outdoor brand from the Pacific Northwest, which is where I'm from, that offers a great selection of trekking poles. They're incredible. Super coolers, camp chairs, LED lighting, and much more. Right now, Cascade Mountain Tech is offering 15% off your first order by using the code FINDINGYOURSUMMIT15, that is FINDINGYOURSUMMIT15, when you check out at CascadeMountainTech.com.
Well, again, I didn't probably think it through, although it's played out wonderfully and in a beautiful way in terms of the name of this podcast, Finding Your Summit. It really can apply to anybody doing anything. It has really nothing to do with the mountains. And, you know, I've been
right.
Very, very, very fortunate. Again, didn't really think it through at the time, but I've done 100-plus episodes. And to be on the side of the mic and hear stories of just tremendous amount of internal grit and fire and tenacity to do some of the things that people do, because it's out there, because somebody said that they couldn't. I get inspired. And, you know, I know not people totally. Say, like, Mark, you're inspiring. Well, you know, you can do the same stuff I'm doing. I just happen to do it because I fell into a bad spot and I decided to do something about it. And I put my head down, set a bunch of goals, and I've gone after it. And then all these other gifts have come my way, and not monetarily,
exactly.
But just, you know, again, the power of the human connection with other people, getting to know people like you. And it's been a blessing. So,
well, likewise, man, because when you go out and do what you do, it literally inspires me. Like in prep for today, I went onto your website and then I was like, this man, I got to go for a run this afternoon. Like, I'm not kidding. Literally, I'm inspired by your example. And this is how we all help each other, right?
Yeah, well, it's a global community. And I think
yep.
that's certainly what I'm inspired by, and what I'm motivated by is I you know, I do climb and those things by myself, but I have the best time ever. I climb every day, or most every day, with my best friend Jim Mora, who is coach at UCLA and longtime NFL coach. And
right,
you know, the power of community, of sharing stories or things we're going through, and you're being out there with that, your phone going off, is a powerful thing, and has really helped, I think, both of us overcome a lot of different adversity that we personally have gone through. So I want to, So I want to ask you one last question, and this has to do with one of your books. You mentioned this in about minute two of the pod, just in more of a reference, but you did you created a book, wrote a book, and I love the name. The Map Is Not the Journey. Faith Renewed While Hiking in the Alps. So obviously it's what I take away from that is that you know, you need to have a, like a power booster or a supercharge, whatever word you want to use while you're hiking in the Alps to really get you refocused on what you're doing today.
Yeah. What happened was, like, I'd been at this church for basically 19 years. And at some point you run a risk of just kind of going through the motions, right? You know, get up, do your thing, meetings, budgets, staff, preach, study, rinse, repeat, but you lose the passion. That's a danger for anybody in any role. And so we were outwardly successful, but I was feeling like I needed to either quit or find like a refocus or perspective. So I asked for 3 months off, and my wife and we hiked for 40 days in the Alps. We started in Italy, so the journey ended up being Italy to Austria, Austria to Germany, Germany to Liechtenstein, Liechtenstein to Switzerland, Switzerland back to Austria, and then we were done. And it just was so rich. And the book ends up being about lessons learned along the way, lessons about endurance, lessons about adaptation, lessons about shelter, lessons about community. And it's so interesting because you were just talking about climbing with your buddy Jim. And my original plan was I was gonna hike the Pacific Crest Trail, a 40-day section through from northern Oregon to the Canadian border. I was gonna hike a 40-day section. And instead, a buddy of mine died in a paragliding accident in Europe at a Bible school in Austria. And so they had asked me to come over there and spend some extra time teaching. And since I had this 3 months off, I knew I could do it. So as a result of that, we ended up hiking through the Alps instead. And I was really kind of looking forward to the solitude of hiking alone on the PCT. But now when you hike through the Alps, people are not into backpacking in the Alps. They hike from hut to hut, and they kind of frown on people using tents, actually. So you end up every day hiking to a hut. You get there, you put down about 40 euros or so, and 40 euros buys you a bed for the night and dinner and breakfast. It's just amazing, right? But now I'm not alone anymore. I'm with people, and my summary thing that happened in the entire experience was my time with the people.
Yeah. I mean, everything you just recounted about that story is near and dear to my heart because again, I said this before, but I put the Seven Summit goal out there and that's the ultimate ambition to take the top, but it's all the preparation that goes along with it about preparing,
totally.
You know, all that stuff. And then you get to these different countries and you go up and the interaction you have. And there's some people that you learn from and the other people you don't, but it's just that whole community that are like-minded that really feeds your soul. And just like there's another way of doing it. You don't have to be the same old brick and mortar like many of us.
Absolutely.
Right?
We met 80-year-old nuns who were hiking hut to hut, you know, and super hardcore athletes who were hiking hut to hut and rock climbing along the way. I mean, we met everybody, and you just go, man, what a beautiful world that God has created, all the diversity of people. And the one thing that glued us all together, our love of the mountains. I mean, we were atheists, communists, gay, straight, whatever. But we all love the mountains, and that just created such incredible, beautiful times. I mean, we want to do it again, my wife and I, actually. So, it'll be fun in the future.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. Well, listen, I have thoroughly enjoyed the conversation. I know you have a website called stepbystepjourney.com. And is there any other place where people can come and listen to you? And for everybody out there, I have been, as I mentioned at the beginning of the pod, I've been to the Bethany Church in Seattle and I've listened. I mean, you definitely have a gift of communication and the way you articulate your messages in not a preachy way, but just a way that everybody can relate to that. So the question is, where else can people find you beyond your website?
You bet. Yeah. And I would say, The church website is churchbcc. So that's like B as in boy, churchbcc.org. And then you can find like literally hundreds of talks on there. Just go look up, you know, Richard Dahlstrom, and I'll be on there. And then my two other books are, one's called Colors of Hope, and that's really saying that the reason we exist is to fill the world with generosity and mercy and hope. And how can we do that? So that's a book. And the other book is called Breathing New Life into Faith. Those are available along with The Map Is Not the Journey on Amazon, of course, and elsewhere. So, yeah, it's really a joy chatting with you too, Mark. I mean, just amazing to see what you're doing. And I wish you all the best. It looks like you have a couple more mountains to go, right?
Well, I mean, as it relates to the seven summits, I've got one, and it's the biggest boy on the block, Mount Everest. That will happen next April, 2020. Totally stoked to go do that. And as I said before, you know, I've been prepping for this, having grown up in the state of Washington. I'm running up Mount Rainier in 2 weeks, and I continue to train daily here in Sun Valley. So really working on my game and working on my altitude fitness. And, you know, I put myself in the best position to hopefully get to the top and back safely this next year.
Well, I'm super excited for you. And you say you're out hiking with Jim Mora. My mountain bike buddy is Jim Zorn, right?
So great guy.
He and I kind of push each other along the trails up here in Washington as well, which is tons of fun. Yeah. So thank you again, my friend.
Yeah, thank you. Okay. So everybody, Pastor Richard Dahlstrom, thank you so much.
Thanks again.
Hey, thank you so much for dropping in and listening to another amazing episode of Finding Your Summit. Truly incredible people doing spectacular things in life, and I hope you were inspired just like I continue to be. Look, I am super grateful that you came in and subscribed to this pod, and would be more than appreciative if you gave the show a ratings and review on iTunes. Trust me, it matters. And then also go share it with your friends, of course. Okay, until next week, go do something great, and remember, it takes a little more to make a champion. Bye. Hey, and thank you so much for listening to the Find Your Summit podcast. We are so glad to have you along for this journey. And if you enjoy the show, please tell a friend, share it on iTunes, spread it to the planet. We're looking to broadcast this to every person that is out there because, as you know, everybody has their own summit that they're going after. Okay, if you're looking to follow my journey, you can find that through my social links on markpattisonnfl.com. That's Mark, M-A-R-K, Pattison, P-A-T-T-I-S-O-N, nfl.com. So, until the next podcast, just remember, clear eyes, full hearts, and remember, it takes a little more to make a champion, so make it happen. Thank you. Bye.